Welcome, ladies. Good day and welcome to today's Lead 360 Her LeaderCast. My name is Dorinda Walker and I am head of programming for Lead 360 and the host of this LeaderCast series, which is designed specifically for Black women in leadership. For those of you who are not familiar with Lead 360 and who are joining us for the first time, we are a professional development organization dedicated to the advancement of Black middle managers and senior leaders. In the words of our founder and CEO, Dr. Eric Walton, we believe that Black leaders matter. At Lead 360, we are proud and unapologetic about our desire to uplift Black professionals. There's an African proverb that says the best way to fight an alien and oppressive culture is to embrace your own. And today I am proud to moderate a discussion about Black culture with three dynamic and powerful leaders who not only embrace Black culture, but have blazed trails to ensure that others respect Black culture.
Yes, Dorinda, yes. I'm sorry. Amen.
Let's welcome Pepper Miller, principal consultant, award-winning market researcher, speaker, Black America expert, and author. Michelle Thornton G., author and managing partner at Strategic Alliance. And Marv Frazier, Senior Vice President and Chief Content Officer at iOne Digital. Welcome, ladies.
Thank you for having me.
It's a pleasure to have you here. So before we get into discussion on culture, let's have the viewers get some insight about who you are as powerful leaders in business. So Pepper, I'm going to start with you because I love the fact that when you were rejected as a candidate for a market research training program with a well-known agency at the time, you resigned and opened up your own market research firm. You said, hey, I'm not going to beg for a seat. I'm going to create my own. And you did the daggone thing.
Absolutely.
Okay. You blazed trails and helping brands like General Mills, PepsiCo, Procter & Gamble, just to name a few, to understand Black America. And you co-authored What's Black About It with Herb Kemp, which I love, which was my go-to when I was in corporate America. And it's considered to be, by many, one of the most important books on African-American culture, marketing, and insights. And in your latest book, Black Matters in Marketing, you help marketers better understand the importance of making a real and meaningful connection with today's Black consumer through cultural insights, stories, stats, and case stories. You state that you find the meaning in helping people change their perceptions about Black Americans. Tell us about your work and why you find meaning in that and you feel it's part of your life's purpose.
Well, thank you, Dorinda. I'm happy to be here. Marv and Michelle, hey, lovely to be on the panel with you. So I am the target, you know, I am the purpose. I lived for 5 years in the segregated South in Albany, Georgia, and I heard the governor use the N-word to refer to Black people. I was about 7 years old, and he called us niggas. You know, he was talking to his constituents because Black people wanted to integrate the, you know, the college, and he said he wasn't going to allow it to happen, and I was mortified. I knew he was important, but I was, like, mortified. But it changed me. It left an indelible mark on my heart. We just lived there for 5 years. And I've just always been different. I've always been curious. When I left the ad agency, J. Walter Thompson, I wanted to do research. And I was told I couldn't do mainstream research because I was Black pretty much. And thank God for Burrell and Salkeen and Graham Chisholm and Eugene Morris, who gave me an opportunity. It's where I heard and really understood the gaps that was happening in marketing in terms of how they didn't really connect with us. So I started one of these multicultural marketing conferences and we weren't there. No one was representing Black people. So I just had to keep stepping up and stepping up and stepping up and writing books and blogging and getting the word out and sending out things to get the word out to people. So it is important. I am the target. I am Black. I am, you know, representing our culture for so many of us, you know, in the industry. And I'm always looking for the next Pepper Miller, if you will, or Michelle Lee or Marv Frazier or Dorinda Walker. Always looking for the next one to keep our Blackness and our culture moving forward, particularly in our industry.
Well, thank you for that. And those of us in the marketing industry so appreciate you and the work you do to keep Black culture and Black insights relevant. So thank you for that. So Michelle, you're up next. You've been very public about your commitment to your father, Walt Thornton, and your promise to make him proud as you sat beside him before he passed on. And there's no doubt that you are a woman of your word. You're a very successful executive who's generated billions of dollars, created multicultural practices, implemented diversity and inclusion tactics, and created new business strategies at some of the largest media companies in the world, including BET, CNN, and Endeavor. You received many accolades and awards, including Working Mother of the Year by Advertising Week New York, she runs it, Women to Watch by Multichannel News, named a 2019 Wonder Woman by Multichannel News, and you received an honorary doctorate of humane letters from Golden Gate University. I can say with certainty that your dad is indeed proud of all that you have accomplished, and so am I. I'm proud to call you a friend. Yeah. But with all the accolades and accomplishments you received in the your corporate career, you felt compelled to branch out as an author and design and build your own and your newest endeavor with Strategic Alliance. Tell us about your career trajectory, the work you're doing now, and why it's important to you.
So let me say this. First, this is an honor to be on with all of you women. And I would say that I didn't have a choice. You know, some people have a choice. We have to be excellent. And even being excellent, you're still questioned. So without the Pepper Millers saying and giving us information and numbers, because we have to come in the door over and over and over again, and they raise the hurdle higher again. So did I want to create a multicultural business? I don't know. I had to really continue to move in this marketplace. I had to create a BET Her so that people could see that, you know, I'm important. I had to write a book because I was still invisible after 20 years. How the hell am I invisible with all that I've done, every accolade that I've had? So I didn't really have a choice because I'm just trying to take care of my family like everybody else. And that's real talk. And I can talk like that now because I'm my own person. I'm running my own business. I don't have to answer to people in the same way. And the beauty of the time that we're in is that people now actually want to hear what the hell we have to say. But you should have wanted to hear before, right? Because you are profiting off of us. We are watching more screens, and Pepper can quantify this. Black women spend 60 hours a week on some type of device. We're buying more products. We're starting more businesses. We are the aggregators of community and culture. So we're important. So what I have to say is this, is like, I'm the target, but I was also the employee, but you never took the time to ask me, and I'm sitting at the table, how we move, think, and breathe. So now I started my own firm to answer that question. Like, you gotta use the people that are there. You have to include them or your business is not gonna be what it's supposed to be. So my tagline is conquering the difference. And that's what I'm doing every damn day with Strategic Alliance.
Thank you for that. Let me tell you something. If you ever walk into a room with Michelle Thornton G, you will never be invisible, okay?
She is. Yo, these fools out here, though, I'll tell you right now, corporate America is wilding, yo. It's like, what you doing? That's so good. But that's the point. Seriously, like, if I'm invisible, like, well, then how is the person who's not 5'10", with green eyes and blonde hair, like, what are they doing? Like, it's this time. It's like, stop it. Come on, corporate America. You could do better. This is ridiculous. I'm sorry. Go on, Martha. Hey, Mom, how you doing, girl?
It is our time. And Marv, what I really admire about you is that you are an unapologetic trailblazer and building brands, content creation, digital strategy, marketing, and television production. Girl, you're the bomb, okay? You are recognized for leading Bossip to become a globally recognized pop news outlet. The site was named in the Inc. 5000, recognized in GQ, and named in Yahoo's top 10 celebrity blogs of the year, among other accolades. And as chief creative officer at Mogul, the media group, you develop creative, innovative, and actionable ideas across the properties, which include Bossip, Madame Noir, Hip Hop Wired, Style Blazer, AKF Insider, and AKF Travel. You drove the creative vision for Moguldom Studios and acted as executive producer for all films and series, in addition to being an executive producer of WeTV's hit show Bossip, on WeTV. Marv, this is just a glimpse of your bio, and you are certainly blazing trails and taking no prisoners. Tell us about your career trajectory, what drives your passion, and the work you're doing now at iOne Digital.
Okay, so first and foremost, I just wanted to say, like everyone else here, it's truly an honor to be here sitting and chatting with all of you amazing women. For me, as far as I'm gonna hit the career trajectory at the end, but for me, what drives my passion and the work that I do now at iOne Digital, which is very similar to what I was doing at Moguldom, it's just really just, you know, strategically figuring out what the strategies are for all of the brands, which currently are Bossip, Hip Hop Wire, Madame Noir, Hello Beautiful, Cassius, News One, Global Grind, et cetera, et cetera. If I'm missing one, I'm sorry. But it's seven altogether that I lead. And, you know, we're really like in a place now where Black culture has always been imitated, right? My Bossip brand, for example, has been imitated so much that, you know, we're at the point now where, you know, folks really look for that headline. They look for the funniness because I put that into all of my teams and I make sure that they have and they live in this level of authenticity, right? So you can't really be successful in this business because everybody's doing the same thing. Everybody is talking about celebrity news. Everybody's talking about this, that, and the third. But what makes you different? What's the biggest differentiation that we have? And that's really, you know, building what these brands are and having a brand strategy and aligning with that. So that's a lot of what I'm doing at iOne Digital as well. From a passion standpoint, what drives my passion is just us beautiful Black people. We have to be here for each other. Can't really be in a place where, you know, there's a lot of, specifically a lot of our competitors who aren't necessarily Black owned or Black based, and they're, you know, stealing all of our advertising. You know, we get in position where like, well, you guys don't have the scale of Refinery 29, or you don't have the scale of Complex and all of that. But I'm like, look, I have an authentic team here that everybody there is unapologetically Black and everybody is going hard for what we do. But, you know, still in the long run, we're losing out to these, you know, general market situations that have the scale and they have a Black scale and the Black folks are going to it. So so for me, that's really what drives my passion is to continue to try to grow our audience as much as I can because we are coming from a place of unapologetic Blackness. And as far as the career trajectory goes, I'm just going to be open and talking about my personal journey that I'm on right now. I love to hear like Pepper and Michelle talk about their purpose and what they're really here for. And for me, I feel like, you know, I've served my purpose from a media standpoint, and I'm really looking to move forward into some of the things that I personally align with, and what's really within my purpose isn't necessarily media, I don't think. So I'm in the process of figuring all that out, but moving towards, you know, my personal creativity and things that I've really am into, but also just being able to be there for our people and be able to help and serve with whatever I do.
Thank you for sharing that. What I can say that all you ladies have in common is that definitely part of your purpose was to make it easier for the people that come behind you. So I personally want to thank all of you for what you have done and what you will continue to do. So I'm going to ask you to put your microphones on mute because we are going to show a video. And, you know, as we move into the cultural conversation, there's no denying the positive and profound impact that Black culture has on our society. So let's take a look at this video by Google to give our audience a glimpse of Black power and influence.
It's just like life. All right.
So ladies, I think that video pretty much sums it up about our impact and our influence. But we're living in a time where Black people continue to fight for racial injustice and equality. I recently watched a video with Hunger Games star Amanda Stenberg, where she asked a thought-provoking question. What would America be like if we loved Black people as much as we love Black culture? So I'm going to ask you all, how do you define Black culture, and what impact do you believe the Black Lives Matter movement and the corporate commitments towards fighting for racial equality have on the marketing and media industry moving forward? And Pepper, I'm going to start with you.
Okay. So Black culture is American culture. Black culture is collard greens and fried chicken. It's our music. It's our language. It's all of that. It's our history. Today to Black culture is about identity. I love that Marv kept talking about being unapologetically Black. That is our normal now. It's our new normal that's going to last. It's a new standard, if you will. So Black culture is also about identity. 61% Black parents believe that culture and race and ethnicity shapes their child's identity versus 41% of white parents who do not. 75% of Black parents have discussion about race with their children as young as 5 years old versus 75% of white parents who do not. So those stats though were before George Fraser. So now we're also living in this society of, according to my friend Joe Fraser, you guys know him, the networking guru, serial entrepreneur. He said something really interesting the other day. He said that marketing and society, too, for that matter, will always be defined pre-Trump, COVID, and George Floyd, and after Trump, COVID, and George Floyd. That was a perfect storm. And so we're always going to be defined by that. And so the impact of the Black Lives Matter movement and that perfect storm, if you will, is magnanimous. It's magnanimous because it started this conversation that we've never had before. I've never seen companies en masse come together to make statements about how they're going to change. And importantly, I'm so happy that Black people, particularly in the industry, have come together. I've never seen that. They've come together to stand together to hold these companies accountable. So things will always be different because of our culture. Black culture is American culture. It is us. It is all of us.
Thank you for that. Marv, I'm going to jump to you next.
So for me, I'm going to kind of like take a little step back here and not really kind of go with the whole, what the movement is and what the culture is, because I have a Black son who's 15 years old and 6'3", who I'm raising. Thankfully, I have his dad, my husband, my father, so many Black men around in our support system to really you know, make him understand what it is to be a proud Black man and what to do and how us Black women support that. But also, you know, I'm in Georgia and I actually live in a predominantly white area where all of his white friends, they wish they were Black, right? They wish they were Black until things like this happen, right? So where do we get to teach our children what's right? You know, because from a Black culture standpoint, I know that we are amazing. Like, just like that video you showed, we are the most searched for everything. We invent things. We have all the swagger in the world that everybody wished they had, right? Everybody on the face of this earth. But for me, it's still making sure that this movement and this moment isn't just within this moment, and it continues to live on with the legacies that we create within the kids that we have, right? So for me, I even have my son, who is a natural leader as well. I'm like, hey, dude, you need to talk to your friends about this, and you need to make sure that they truly understand. And I have, you know, our white moms coming to me, texting me, asking how they can explain this to, you know, their kids and what they need to do and how they explain that to their families. I also have had, you know, some of our friends who we've been friends with forever, like, hey, let me take you out to lunch and let's, and I don't know if it was a white guilt lunch or what it was, but let me take you out to lunch to kind of see what your thoughts on it. How do I communicate with my Black colleague who's going through this, but I don't really know how to talk to them, right? So it's like putting us as Black people at the forefront of all this, but then it's also our responsibility to teach everybody how to understand our culture. I don't think that that's really fair, number one. But number two, I think that this puts us in the position globally for everybody to understand that this is not our problem, it's a whole thing problem, and we need to move forward accordingly. And everybody needs to figure out how to educate themselves, because it's not the Black people's job, but we're gonna continue to be dope and blessed AF, as my shirt says, you know what I mean? But I just wanna make sure that this Black Lives Matter continues and it goes on throughout our legacies and our kids' legacies and continue on. Because if it stops and it's like, oh, Black Lives Matter, and it's like a hashtag and it's a thing, but you know, it dies out with any other trend, that's not what we need to build here. We really need to build something that is here permanently and put Black people in the position that they need to be and not, you know, treat it the way we are.
Thank you for that, because it is not our job to educate everyone about us. Michelle, how about you?
You look, I tell people, Google it, okay? Because you can find anything out today. You know what? Black culture is so difficult to, because it's so magical and amazing and special, right? So, you know, it is how we move and think and flow and communicate and give and have empathy. And it's all the amazing things about us that you can't put in a bottle. You can't really, like, you can play sports and you can play music, but the essence of what who we are, like, you can't really have that. And that's why people are always striving to just get a little touch of, you remember back in the day, people just wanted to touch the hem of Jesus's garment because they knew it would change their life. And that's, please don't nobody say I'm equating Black culture to Jesus, okay? Because you know I'm a woman of faith. I will come fight somebody. But you know what I'm saying? It has that amazing, magical appeal. Now, this is the challenge. When you work for companies that use culture all the time as part of their tagline, oh yeah, we're in the culture business because it's sports or entertainment or this and that. And then this is what happens. So they hire you because you're Black culture and they're a cultural company, so they think, but then they ask you to assimilate into the culture. So then what just happened? Because now I'm not bringing all of the essence, all of the magic, all of the amazing that I am to actually help you look at your company differently, approach the marketplace differently. You asked me to fit in at a water cooler, and that's not what anything. So I really wish that people would just take the word culture out of their vernacular, unless they really understand what it is. So that's the first thing. So everybody needs a damn culture test when you walk in the door. Do you know what culture is? Okay, no, you failed. Don't get to say that. And the last thing I would say is this, around the whole Black Lives Matter. What are people doing when the lights are off, when the sirens aren't going, when nobody's picketing in front of your building. See, because those are the people that are going to continue the movement. Those are the people that are going to embrace that this is not about anything other than us making this world the best place possible. And that's giving the people that have earned the right their rightful place. And when that happens, everybody's going to be better. So listen, we know P&G is down because they've been down before it was about anything else. Like, so there are companies out there that we know. All the other ones, I'm still watching and I'm waiting. And guess what? What I hope the marketplace does is continue to put them on blast, because it's, they think just because the light is shining that they can say, oh yeah, you know, this matters. As soon as the lights go out, I'm going to be right there with my magnifying glass like, okay, you didn't tell the truth. And I hope consumers are following the same thing, because our money matters, our culture matters, our families matter. And don't just talk, don't be a liar. Like, that's the worst offense to me. Just say, I don't believe. Okay, cool, then I can respect that.
Yeah. So one of the things that I'm experiencing is I'm getting calls from recruiters asking me about different various D&I positions.
Yeah.
So I ask, is it a C-suite position? Is there a budget, right? And do I have staff? And when the answer is no to all three, I'm like, they're not serious. Don't call
They're not serious.
Yeah, don't call me with that. And it's easy for companies to write checks.
Yep.
But what are they doing to really make sure that they're tracking the impact, particularly economically, educationally? And we still know that, you know, there's such a shortage of Black leaders. Yeah. There's no excuse as to why we're not in the pipeline of the executive and C-suite. So I'm like you. I'm watching and I'm waiting.
You know, it's a good point, because think about a lot of the D&I positions that exist or that are out there are administrative. They're not thought leadership positions. They're not immersing you into the fabric of the business. You don't have any line sight to the executive team. You're not given money to pursue the things that you want to do. I want to say this because I think it's really important. Dorinda, I'm not trying to hijack your call, but yesterday someone had the nerve to get on Twitter, and I don't know if people saw this, but they had the nerve to say something about ad color. And when I tell you, y'all go look on Twitter and see what happened. Everyone reared up and said, you don't get to speak about ad color. You ain't stood in the hallway. You haven't done anything. So don't even mention ad color's name, because whatever you want to say, what ad color's done is put me in positions, and I've hired 10 other people. Tiffany R. Warren is a thought leader, not an administrator. So you shut your face and you don't get to say anything about that organization. But people want to just talk sideways because they're, don't talk without education.
Yeah. All right, ladies, I'm going to move to the next question, which is for Pepper. So we all know that Black culture is widely celebrated, but is often misappropriated by non-Blacks to serve personal and business interests. In conducting your work, how do you help business leaders and brands avoid cultural appropriation?
So it's been the same story over and over again for how they should approach the Black consumer market, period. I mean, number one, they have to have the talent. This has been the first time, I mean, there was an aha moment for society and business leaders when Barack Obama was in office. There was no aha moment. We were post-racial. And then when Donald Trump got elected, that was an aha moment. So this is the first time they've had, as time calls it, an overdue awakening. And for the first time, they've looked around the room and they've seen that we are not there. We're not at the table and we're not in the room. So that's the opportunity. Number one is to hire the right talent. You have to have them not only in the room, but at the table, and then to hear their voices. And then you have to, when hearing their voices, it's about practicing, collaboration. So people come up with ideas. I mean, I've been hired a lot of times. You know, you're the expert. You understand the Black consumer. I give them my advice. I support them with numbers, as Michelle talked about, insights. And then they go and do whatever they want to. They don't listen to us. That is not real collaboration, because you wrote me a check. So real collaboration is about coming correct and listening and taking our advice and doing what they're supposed to do. You have to invest in relevant research. I mean, relevant research, where you're doing a study just with Black folks. I can't tell you how many times Black people in focus groups, I ask them, how many of you been in all Black focus group? Never, never. In 2020 America, Black people are not in an all Black focus group, for example. So they're not doing enough research with just us, by us, to understand us. And the last thing is to the empower the audience, kind of like what the Black Lives Matter movement has done, to stand up kind of like what Michelle and Mark are saying and continue to support, you know, what you're doing and getting them involved and galvanizing them, hiring the right talent, practicing real collaboration, coming correct, and investing in research and engaging the audience are things that companies can do. And I'm looking at my notes. I wrote about this in an article. You must come correct if you want to be a part of my culture.
So. Awesome. Thank you for sharing, Marv. Michelle, do you want to chime in on that as well?
I mean, I think Pepper did an amazing job when she talked about that, because really it is about the numbers. Like, those cannot be denied. Now, if they don't want to use those numbers, that's really like, how can you control the output on that? But at least you're providing them numbers. And I think more companies need to actually look at the numbers, own the number, and then operate from a number perspective. If they did that, then more money would go to different outlets, more money would be used to speak to certain communities, because then there would be equity in how you distribute what's really important, right?
BET has numbers, Nielsen has numbers, the Black
Everybody does. They don't want to hear, like, right? They don't want to roll
never made it because they changed the rules. Yep. So we give them what they want, change the rules. So I'm hoping post Trump, COVID, and George Frazier, this awakening moment, that people will start listening. We have their ear for the first time in a long time. We've been giving them and giving them and giving, yeah. You know, Michelle, and they changed the rules.
Yep.
Marv, you want to chime in?
I think I'm done. I love everything the ladies said.
Yes, Marv, yes. What I do want to say, one of the last things I did before I left corporate America, we were developing a strategy to engage Black consumers. And I walked into a room with the agency they had at the time, and it was all white men and one Asian woman. And I said, no, we're not having none of that. So I bought iOne Digital in, and you guys knocked it out the park. So it's important that we have Black representation as we develop those strategies. So if there's anyone out there in a position of power, make sure that you include us in the room. So next question is for Michelle. From your perspective, what are the biggest challenges faced by Black-owned media and agencies to remain relevant in a multi-billion dollar media industry?
Let me say this. You know, companies like ours, right, Dorinda and Pepper, if we don't have advocacy, then we are not going to be successful, because we know that what happens is they carve up money in the marketplace. So it's general market gets 90% of the dollars, and then multicultural gets 10%. So my question is, why are Black American, okay, right. I'm being generous, okay. Right, but why are we getting the least amount of money, but we have the biggest impact? So that's the first thing. So I believe that we need to have a conversation together. So this is what I know that I have a little bit of power, right? So, you know, some of the clients that, people are gonna find out, some of the clients that I have an opportunity to work with because of the equity that I've built in the marketplace. So when I go in, my thought leadership says, I need to bring 5 companies with me that look like me, because now you're actually doing what you're talking about. Why, just hire me. That's like, well, you ain't like, that's not doing anything. Like, so I'm going to bring people along, and I have it, you know, I'm a sales, like I'm a business development person, but they're going to be in categories. So it's going to be around coaching and development. It's going to be around, you know, media and impressions. It's going to be around research. So I'm going to go up to say, listen, around education, I have a young brother who just created something called social learning. And what you do is you learn via text message, like a young brother, like dope. But those are the type of things that we have to take responsibility to find out and use our underground railroad network to say, yo, who's doing great things? Okay, guess what? I got a foot in this door. I'm bringing 3 of y'all with me. If we don't do that, we're not going to win. And we have to stop being selfish. We have to think that, you know what? I could have a bigger payday if I don't. But God's not going to honor that. He's going to honor the fact that I'm looking out for Dorinda and Marv and Pepper and Amari and Coco. And that's what I'm going to do. And if we all have that attitude, I'm telling you, we're going to be a lot further along, period.
I agree with you. So Marv, you want to weigh in on that one?
No, I completely agree with her, specifically because for me, I mentioned it earlier where, you know, we're in the position where we are a Black-owned media company, and we are making an impact across not only digitally from a radio standpoint, TV, et cetera, but we still, you know, lose out dollars, millions of dollars to general market folks who are getting our audiences, right? And I don't think that that's really something that is fair, but it is what it is, because we also don't have the same resources to, you know, we're not getting that big, you know, VC money from so-and-so to build this crazy large media company where we can just like start off and have all of this resources to do whatever we want, right? We have to work harder. We have to do everything harder, and it's really sucks. But what, you know, Michelle was saying about making sure you bring folks in and making sure you give everybody those chances to make it happen, I think that we also have to really stand to that, because I feel like for me, as a person who has a lot of Black people on my team, it's the sense where, you know, they don't take this job as seriously. Let me circle back. They don't, so they're like, oh, I rather be like, oh, my freelance work that I did at the Washington Post is more important than the work that I did here. Or, you know, the work that I did for Forbes is, I'll put that in, you know, hoot and holler about, ooh, look at my piece. But all of the pieces that I write at my job that pays my salary and my 401k and gives me health benefits every single day, it's like, oh, this is just pays the bills, but here, look at me, this is my bright and shiny thing. And I think that we also, just as Black people, have to get out of that mentality where that bigger, shinier, general market type of publication is the place where you think that is what you have to be successful. Or even now with all of the sports athletes and, you know, the kids saying that they're going to go to HBCUs now, you know, that's a whole thing. Like, this is a whole thing. I take that to even what I do here. It's like the same thing. Like, hey, you want to work at a Black-owned company? It might be, you know what I mean? Versus the latter. But
I think it's going to happen. You know, that, don't take that unapologetically Black lightly. I mean, that's some serious, that's really, really serious. I saw before the Trayvon Martin murder, that's when things changed. The George Zimmerman verdict, that's when a lot of Black millennials discovered that things were not as equal. And then this, again, Trump, COVID, George Floyd has had a tremendous impact. So I think you'll see more of that. I did, Dorinda, I don't want to hijack you either, but I did want to ask Michelle and Marv about this whole point about effectiveness in Black media, because that's something that we've been fighting for too, because they've gone on efficiencies, but we know our media is way effective. We know we have this pass-along rate. We know we talk about the stories a whole lot longer. We know we stick with them longer. We haven't been able to measure it, and that's one of the things that has been preventing us from getting these budgets, you know, as well. Is that off the table? Is it dead? What are we gonna do about that?
Hey, listen, I'm like this. Sometimes we have to use old school grassroots in the hood research, meaning if BET did something or aired something that the Black community felt wasn't part of their family that they could take to church, then they got, I mean, like, we heard from them so much. So we know they're engaged. We know they're paying attention. We know that they're watching, right? Because then they wouldn't be able to react. So sometimes you got to say, look, I got 1,000 text messages or whatever the case is, like, this is how engaged this community is. And if you don't believe this, then shame on you. So you can air that same thing on different networks, but we know that they don't care because they don't really care about that environment. That environment doesn't reflect them. It's not their family. It's not their home. So if it's not my home, I'm really not like, what was that brand again? Right. But on BET, they remember it because they remember everything about it because it's their community. I mean, that's just an example. Right. So we got to stop. And the other thing is this, like, I don't think you have to hold like a gun to someone's head, but sometimes you just got to get in people's faces. Like, I see you, stop it. Like, because I know, you know, that's not going down. And that's why we were able to be so impactful when we were at BET and even building BET Her. We held the marketplace real accountable. It's like, not, because I worked at CNN and you didn't ask me that question when I worked there. So I'm sorry, I'm confused. You just got to hold people accountable. Yeah.
And I agree. And I think for me, even just recently with everything going on with COVID and George Floyd and the Black Lives Matter movement really blowing up the way it should have blew up the last time it, entered the world. We're getting clients coming to us like, well, what are you doing about this? And how are y'all supporting Black owned businesses? I'm like, we support Black owned businesses all day, every day. Like, for me, like, we've been.
We're one of them. Hello.
A, number one. Number two, we've been supporting all of the Black owned, what have you, that align with every single brand that we have. So, you know, it's great that now it's cute for everybody to really be into it. But for me, this is what we've been doing and what we do. And like you said, it, like, we have that impact. But, you know, I'm glad that folks are, you know, now getting traction and getting, you know, the understanding that Black owned businesses are important. Black owned brands are important. I always try to support folks. This shirt is a Black owned company and all that. But for me, I just also think that, like I said before, we just got to keep it going. We got to keep our voices heard and we got to keep pushing and keep moving. So it doesn't die down and go away.
So we have a few questions. So this one is for Marv. Is there a generational divide in approaches to diversity?
I think there's a generational divide just altogether with everything. I just notice for me and what I do and also the folks who I lead, there's the millennials, there's the Gen X folks. I think I'm like a zennial. I'm like in the cusp of those two. But as far as like from a diversity standpoint is, I think the younger people, millennials and the Gen Z's folks, they're like, you know what? If I can't get a job in this corporate America that isn't, you know, accepting me, I'm gonna just do my own thing. They have a completely different viewpoint on how they're not really chasing what, you know, people, you know, in our age group are doing. Like, oh, well, I need to figure out how I can get, you know, into the C-suite in a, you know, corporate America and all that stuff. They're not even really caring about that because they know that they can build their own thing. They know that they can build, you know, and grow and move forward without having to have that. But from the other side, as far as, you know, approaching diversity from a corporate standpoint, I do think that there is a big disconnect, with even understanding what it means to be diverse, or if like, oh, we just sprinkle some Black people in here and sprinkle some Asian people here and sprinkle some, you know, whoever here, and then we'll be able to really, you know, fill our quota. I just think that moving forward now, generationally, they'll think about it differently.
Yeah. I'm doing work with Gen Z right now, and it's interesting because they tell me that they think that they have it much harder than our generations because of technology. They say we can come up with an idea, it'll take off, but then tomorrow somebody has done something bigger and better. So it's interesting their take on our work and how they view the future and their obstacles. So interesting stuff. Thank you for that. The next question is from Tracy Lynn Counts. She'd like to know how she can find opportunities in working with marketing focus groups as a lead. She says she's been a paid participant in a couple of focus groups for several different brands, and the leaders of those groups have always been led by white individuals. And she's often been the only one or one of two Black participants. And Pepper, that was directed at you.
Right, and she sent that question to me as well. So now I'm hearing two different things of, you know, her as a focus group participant, but I thought she was trying to get to be a lead in creative. Is that?
I think it's both.
And so I told her, I said, that's the work that we've been doing for years, is trying to make sure that we're more inclusive. But I did recommend that she get a mentor and someone who could introduce her to people, because I felt like she was a creative person that might have a portfolio. But I think she needs a mentor, someone that could help her network, also someone that can evaluate her portfolio to help her, you know, make sure that her vision comes through, but also that she's in alignment with some, you know, some of the things that the company wants to do as well. And if she wants to be a focus group moderator, that's training. A lot of people think it's sitting and asking people questions, but it's so much bigger than that. You have to understand the client's marketing problems, understand the objective. Sometimes they don't know what they want to do. You have to come up with it. And the objective, then you design the study. Maybe it isn't focus groups, maybe it's something else. But it's a lot involved. It's writing the screeners and discussion guides and making sure you're in alignment with, you know, with what they're trying to do. But getting training for that is important. And I'll reach out to her and share with her some places she can go to get some moderator training. It's not as simple as you may think. It's a lot of pieces.
And if you could post those resources in the feed, that would be great as well.
Sure, I definitely.
So Marv, this next question is for you, because undoubtedly you have proven that you know how to build a brand. What advice would you give to content creators who are looking to build and sustain a media brand?
I think the same thing that I said earlier, that level of authenticity is really a big, big, big part of it. How do you differentiate yourself from everybody else? Because, you know, this is a thing now. Everywhere I go, everybody on the face of the earth is a content creator, right? Everybody's a content creator. So, I mean, you watch reality shows. I was watching the dating one with the people, and they were stuck on the island. They couldn't do stuff. And it was like, so-and-so is a content creator. Everybody's a content creator. So I think that's like the kind of buzzy thing to be right now. And especially with all of the technology and everything that we have, obviously people have a lot more ability to kind of do that. But yeah, you definitely have to have that level of authenticity and what differentiates what you do from everyone else, because there's so much stuff that is going on. There's so much online. There's so much content to consume online. What do you do with your brand that you've created for yourself to be different? What do you do with your brand to connect with the audience that you have? And how do you authentically connect to that audience? And what do you create? And how is it, you know, moving, you know, people, and how is it affecting people, right? So what impact does it have? Is your goal to be funny? Is your goal to be informative? Is your goal to be, you know, I want to tell this story about X, Y, and Z. You have to be able to tell that story in a way that people can relate to and understand. So I think that that's really kind of the biggest thing. And I know that authenticity is a word that we kind of throw around a lot. But for me, I really truly believe that that's the key to building the brands. Because for me, all the brands that you named earlier and the brands that I named that I work on now, a lot of them are successful. Some of them aren't as successful as the other ones, but I do believe that the ones that are super duper successful are because they, you know, really, really honed into that authenticity, into what that brand mission, purpose, all of that was. Just for Bossip, for example, that brand is 14 years old now. And, you know, I remember back when, you know, I first started doing this, it was like all these different other blogs that were in that same mix that none of them are around anymore. I remember our little competition that we used to have with, you know, all these little, nobody's around. And then, you know, it's the sense of like, oh, well, Bossip is the Black TMZ. And I'm like, well, it actually isn't, because TMZ has their specific thing that they do for their audience. They break news. And, you know, for our brand, we do have some exclusives from time to time, but that's not our thing. Our thing is to create hilarious commentary about all the shenanigans that's going on in the world, right? So, you know, for me, I have my team specifically, there are words that they can't say. I'm like, if this is something that everybody is saying, you got to figure out something new to say. You know, create words, create things. We create the culture. We're trendsetters. We move what, you know, everything is going on right now. So that's really...
Can I add to a little bit to that? Yeah. I love what you're saying about being authenticity, how important it is. It's a little old school thing, but I am a big mission and vision person. A lot of companies have these missions and visions and they don't live by them. I live by mine. To add value to the Black American market so that society see our value as the people and as a marketplace. And so everything that we do is about adding value. That's where the books came from. That's why I was doing snapshots. That's why I blogged for Ad Age for 7 years. That's why I did some blogging for Ford. It's about adding value. So when you talk about authenticity and what it looks like, I just wanted to add that on to help explain to your audience. I know a lot of young people, I love they like what you said earlier. I want to get out there and just start my business, but start with something that you believe in that's authentic and stay with it. The second thing is you always have an opportunity to change your mind if it's not working. Always have an opportunity to change your mind. But think about mission and vision when you think about authenticity, and then that will help you to distinguish yourself from other from your competitors.
Absolutely.
And the last thing I want to add, Dee, if you don't mind, is that when I didn't feel like I had a seat at the table, I just created stuff around myself. I built my own brand. And so we also have the power to do that, because a lot of times people ask us, what have you done? It's like, oh, I'm sorry. Look at me. Look what I've done for myself. And that allows me a seat at the table and entry into a door.
Thank you for that, because I'm a big proponent of that.
Absolutely.
Marv, were you done?
Yeah, I'm done. It's all good.
Okay. All right. So before I wrap up, I'd like to remind our viewers to catch the next episode of Lead 360 Her, which is on August 6th. We're going to have a special edition in honor of Black Business Month. Our content in August will be focused on Black female entrepreneurs and small business owners. Our guests include Kamika Smith, founder and CEO of The Boss Network, Nicole Roberts-Jones, founder and CEO of NRJ Enterprises, and Shirley Ann Robertson, CEO of Robertson and Robertson Financial Services. So this last question, why does Black representation and leadership matter in the media industry? Michelle, I'm going to start with you.
I mean, listen, I remember overhearing someone say, but if we hire all of them, what happens to us? And so that's why it is critical that we are in places that we can actually control the narrative, because if we don't have a seat at the table, then there aren't going to be anybody to follow us. Like, we can't expect anyone else to do for us what we can do for ourselves. So it's really important. And I want every young person who's listened to this, like, we have sacrificed, we have compromised, we have done things that maybe my dad wouldn't have been so proud of, because I wanted to cuss people out, but I sucked it up because I know that I have to be in a position to be able to hire you so that they'll look at you and say, oh man, she did a great job, even though I danced just a little bit, right? Because I want my kids to also have an opportunity. And so I just want you to know, like, we're out here in these streets dancing so that you can come in and just do your thing. And so I really want, folks to understand, yes, you have to have a seat at the table. Yes, sometimes you have to compromise without giving up who you are so that you can bring in folks that look like you. Because until we can disseminate like the boardroom, right, and leadership, then we really have nothing. The last thing I'm going to say, I'm with the Speakers Bureau, the Washington Speakers Bureau. And a gentleman that sits on the board and said, Michelle, like, all your talks are like you're one of them when really you're one of them. And I was like, what? He's like, you've been an executive. You've been a leader. So I want your conversation to start saying we, as in we in the boardroom, instead of we that have been victimized. And so I want to tell you that once you do get there, look, I'm part of we. I am an executive. I do have a seat at the table and I'm holding all of these folks sitting next to me accountable. And so you have to put yourself in the right mind and not be a victim all the time to say that I am that person and I'm going to make change from whence I sit.
Love that. Love that. Marv, how about you?
Yeah. So for me, obviously, from a media perspective, it's truly important because, just piggybacking on what Michelle said about us having to, make our own narrative, right? Because you never know what, from a media perspective, things can get skewed and things can get twisted and things can go awry and not really be aligned with what we as a people, live by and what we do. But then also just overall, there needs to be Black representation everywhere throughout corporate America, throughout whatever industry, be it pharmaceutical, be it tech, be this, be that, because we have to make sure that we're building spaces for us to continue to grow and continue to have, you know, all the knowledge that we have, everything that we have. All of our people are so educated. Everybody is so talented. Everybody has the experience, but, you know, when it comes to our color, we might not have those experiences because of that. And making sure we just continue to drive that and continue to make it happen, I think that that's really important. And then also to not, like I go back to what I said before, to be in the room, but not have to be that person in the room who's explaining why this, or like, well, this is how it is when you're a Black person, or this is that, or what have you. But I really think that, you know, representation across the board in any industry, there's necessary to have Black representation across all of it.
And Pepper?
Good answers. I love what Michelle said about controlling the narrative, because I think that's important when we talk about Black leadership. And also holding people accountable. And also providing if that leader is someone that can use his or her Black experiences to lead, there's an opportunity for more innovation. I loved years ago, Neil Golden, who's the former chief marketing officer for McDonald's, talked about leading with Black insights. I mean, he started talking about leading with Black insights, and then he went to multicultural insights. That's a huge opportunity for the Black person in leadership to reach more people. Because when you get it right with Black people, when you understand our culture, you undoubtedly, and use those insights for that, you can create a lot of innovative content, Mark, you can, that could just, you know, kind of distinguish yourself, but also reach more people. So, you know, controlling the narrative, holding people accountable, leading with Black insights, and in making sure that you have an opportunity, as Mark said, to expand to more platforms is the opportunity for Black leadership in media.
And Dorinda, can I just say, I'm sorry, Pepper, you just brought something to my brain. I want to leave this with anybody who watches this now or later. And also, you don't have to be a leader, but you can be a leader in Blackness, right? So there were a lot of times that I sat at a table and I was the only one. And I was a low level person, but guess what? They invited me to meetings because I knew my culture, and I used my voice at the table and explained to people. So they were like, oh, we got to have her come. So don't shy away from who you are and your experiences and your culture, because a lot of time you don't say anything when they actually want you to, and it can put you in a position to one day be a leader.
Exactly. And that's how I climbed the leadership ladder in corporate America. I came with my Blackness and my authenticity.
Yeah.
They needed at the time. We have one more question, then I want to say a few closing remarks to honor the Honorable John Lewis. But this question, Michelle, I'm going to ask you to answer briefly. This is from Tracy Harrell. She's leading a nationwide change initiative called Bigger Than Me Success Series, achieving racial equity and inclusion in business, education, wealth, and health, which is focused on systems of change. What are the best resources and contacts for her to build awareness and activation within both our Black community and for senior leaders in corporate America?
So the question had 100 words in it. So can you tell her to email me at strategic@gmail.com? And I promise her that I will spend more than 1 minute that we have on this call, because I think that question deserves more than that. Don't y'all, everyone else, email me, because she had a good question. Okay. Or she can reach out to me on LinkedIn or DM me on Instagram. But tell her I would love to help her and connect her, if that's, you know, like when people pay attention and ask questions, and I want to be a champion for them. So have her reach out to me directly, Dorinda.
Thank you. Thank you for that. So in closing, I want to pay tribute to the Honorable John Lewis. Today, the world got to celebrate his life and his legacy by viewing his homegoing. He will forever hold a special place in the hearts and minds of people who care about humanity. And in the Black community, he will forever be cherished for standing on the front line for our freedom and our democracy. And I want to leave you all with a small portion of the words he wrote in his final essay. Mm-hmm. It is not enough to say it will get better by and by. Each of us has a moral obligation to stand up, speak up, and speak out. when you see something that is not right, you must say something. You must do something. Democracy is not a state. It is an act, and each generation must do its part to help build what we called the beloved community, a nation and world society at peace with itself. Ordinary people with extraordinary vision can redeem the soul of America by getting in what I call good trouble, necessary trouble. And with that, I want to encourage everyone who's joining us today and who will view this LeaderCast to please honor the legacy of John Lewis by standing tall in the fight for our racial equality. So thank you. Thank you, ladies, for being here with us today. It's been a pleasure, and God bless you all, and good night.
Thank you so much.